Everybody. Everybody. So we know, hands down, Rome has Khazarian blood and Rome has Edomite blood. They call themselves Khazars. We've been saying Caesar because we're trained by them. It's not Caesar. It's a hard C. We just didn't know it. So when you see Caesar is Khazar, they call their emperors Khazars, right in front of our face. All right, so let's knock that one down. We knock study like that down. Let's go to the PDF Two Babylons, and we're gonna make this Druid connection. Two Babylons, and we're gonna make this Druid connection with Constantine. Oh, we almost home. Oh, we almost home. Hallelujah. Two Babylons. It's the PDF. It's back to one of the PDFs. So we're just going to run down and show you how Constantine is tied to the Druids. Because that's where he started off at when he was ruling the Druid Empire. And Elder, we're just going to run these down. Page 73.
Yeah, Druids highlighted.
We're gonna go through all the highlights of the Druids, pretty much.
Okay. So this one is on.
Remember, Constantine and his father started ruling Gaul and Britain. Thank you. And those were Druid lands. That's how Constantine got that Druid influence. So this is Two Babylons. This was written by a Catholic priest, and he came to the knowledge like, everything we doing in Rome, in the Catholic Church, we got from Babylon. That's when I started off, Babylon is that great whore. Babylon is the great whore. We start right here, Elder.
Okay.
The cow of Athor.
Oh, yeah, this is page 42.
Okay, awesome.
Okay. I'm just going to go off a little bit.
Rome just borrowed everything from Babylon. That's why Babylon is the great whore, and she doesn't fall until the end. You can close that up, because we just want to navigate the pages.
Okay. All right. The cow of
Athor,
however, the female divinity corresponding to Apis, is well known as a spotted cow. And it is singular that the Druids of Britain also worship a spotted cow.
So the Druids of Britain, where Constantine started his rulership, worship a spotted cow. What does the Catholic priest wear?
Black and white.
A black robe.
With the collar, the white and black collar.
White right there.
Yeah, right there.
A spotted cow.
Yeah.
You see how they following, you're following paganisms.
Yeah.
On top of paganism. Our people are lost, man. Lost. So that's just one connection to show you that Druid Constantine connection. Let's go to the next one. We'll run these down.
Okay.
I'm getting hungry myself.
All right. Let me start off with. Okay. To the worship of the sun in the character of the revolver, there was a very distant allusion, not only in the circle, which among the pagans was the emblem of the sun god.
What was this emblem of the sun god?
There was
the circle.
Yeah, circle.
Queen, those images we seen last week, what did they have behind those heads?
Circle.
The sun. The sun disk. Mm-hmm. Sun worship. The word circle comes from a German word, Kirke.
Yeah.
The daughter, she's the daughter of the sun god. That's why we don't use the word church. The word church goes back to a pagan word, Kirke, or the daughter of the sun god. And being in circles, you know how in church we used to hold hands in circle? That's all paganism. Nowhere in the scrolls is for us to get in the circle and hold hands. We got that from the pagans, sun worship. Read.
And the blazing wheel with which was so frequently represented. But in the circular dances of the Bacchanalians, hence the phrase Barsiridium, the William Evan Bakkenitz, well, let me skip that. Hence also the circle of dancers and the Druids, as referred to in the following quotation from the Druid song, Ruddy was the sea beach, whilst our circular revolution was performed by the attendants and the white bands in graceful extravagance.
So the Druids are following Babylon, who, you know, Bacchus was one of Bacchanal, is from Babylon, and the Druids are doing it. Constantine started his reign among the Druids. He brought all those things together that he was, as he's taking over the world, he's just bringing all the worship together. We're going to have everything. Syncretism. Syncretism. Sis?
I heard the name Bacchanal. You know, in the West Indies, where we're having carnival, which is a, you know what that word is, it's also called Bacchanal. It's losing the clothes, drinking, wow, in the streets and all that stuff. And I'm thinking about it, and I'm like, that is totally
wrong. That's where we get the word in the scriptures, don't be carnal. Because carnal represents flesh.
Yeah.
So you're doing whatever your flesh. Carnival,
you
Bacchanal.
Very simply dressed in carnival and Bacchanal.
Now you see, I don't have the gift of prophecy or seeing. But when those storms came and tore up the islands,
yeah,
they practiced Bacchanal. Our Puerto Rican family in South America, they got that Santeria, New Orleans, all those skull masks and all that. That's the Day of the Dead. Y'all Israelites, descendants of ancient Israel, and y'all got over here supposed to be coming back to the Most High, and y'all just said, we over here, we're going to park Bacchanal up. We're going to carnival it up. Most High says, time's running out. Come out of her, my people.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Don't be partakers of her sin.
We can go to the next. You know what? For the sake of time, Elder, let's navigate to page 129 and just get the last couple of ones. I think it's plain to see how Constantine blended or synchronized all the religions in Rome. The story was that he became a Christian and Christianity became the official state religion. No, he just made it illegal for you to kill a Christian who was an Israelite. So what Constantine really did, he was the first one to record on law freedom of religion.
Right.
Sounds familiar. Constantine said, we ain't killing nobody. Everyone's going to serve their God. Remember, he said, I wish everyone would be a Christian, but I compel none. Constantine says, we're going to have a smorgasbord of everybody.
Yeah.
Everybody. So this is another one. This is page 129 of Two Babylons. Elder. They were practiced
also in the most savage form of the gladiatorial shows, in which the Roman people, with all their boasted civilization, so much delighted. The miserable men who were doomed to engage in these bloody exhibitions did not so generally of their own free will. But yet, the principle on which these shows were conducted was the very same as that which influenced the priests of Baal. They were celebrated as proprietary sacrifices. From Fuss, we learned that gladiatorial shows were sacred to Saturn.
So what he's saying is, y'all know who were the victims of the gladiator shows in Rome. They were our ancestors, the Israelites. But he was saying, they wasn't doing that just for sport. They were offering our ancestors as sacrifice to Baal, what they got from Babylon. So we thought they just was evil and want entertainment. But our ancestors, as they were getting ate by those beasts, was the Roman sacrifices to their gods.
Use his game.
You see, this law is serious. That's why I've been wanting to smack fire out of people talking about this grace. We're over here because you're talking about grace. That's what got us over here.
Yeah.
Another thing that came to my spirit, they say the law is all works. And now because of faith, no man's... What confirmation did our ancestors get when they brought the sacrifice to the priest? Did they get a receipt for that sacrifice?
No.
So what confirmation did they have that Yah accepted their sacrifice?
Like the blessing, you know, the rain, the crops, you know, or like the...
You was green with
elder. Yeah, the blessings,
yeah.
The rain. That their harvests will be full.
Let me be more specific. For the sin offerings. Because what you're saying is free will offers and God's blessing you, and that's true. When I sinned and I brought an offering to the priest, did he give me a receipt saying that my sins were remitted?
No.
What confirmation did I get? There really wasn't none. I had to have faith that Yah was going to keep his word.
Right.
So they let the Jesuit society tell you that the law is all about works, and now it's all about faith. But I had to have faith in Yah keeping his word. It says if I repent and bring him an offering, he was going to forgive me.
Right.
Because when I walked away from the priest, he didn't give me a receipt saying, yeah, I got this from Yah. You forgiven.
Right.
So them teaching our scrolls, you got me in error. Faith. The law is not all works. I had to have faith and take Yah at his word. Hallelujah, see, man.
They're not defining the word faith properly. Woo. You talk about, you said, I'm not something established. So our record shows what Yah did when we kept the law, statutes, and commandments. He blessed us. So they did, you know, they were going off a precedent. They wasn't going off some airy notion.
I can't wait till you get up here and get your break, boy.
That's right.
You see how it makes sense how y'all blessing us to come back and all this stuff is making sense?
Yeah.
Hebrew is a concrete culture. You give me this faith, and what is faith? I can't see no faith.
Yeah, because
faith is the substance of things hoped for. Where's that at? That's tainting our scrolls. We're going to get Paul wouldn't write nothing like that. Mm-hmm. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, things. Evidence of things not seen. That's philosophy, huh?
Yeah.
No, we got Amana. Yeah. Y'all said, if I do this, he's going to come through.
And I was, you know, just to add, I was meditating on that faith thing. And, you know, because I always wondered what Messiah meant when he was telling them, oh, ye have little faith. Well, he said, why you have little faith? You know, and it makes sense. You know what happened before. You know what.
Why you don't have nothing to stand on?
Stand on, yeah.
Why you don't have, I brought your ancestors through the band Egypt. I brought water from a rock.
Right.
That's why family, and when those songs, sisters was playing those songs, everything is about to happen again, family. When these people who look like us are out of food and your loaf of bread is lasting for months.
Right.
And he's like, I ain't brought no bread. It's going to happen again.
Yeah.
The oil not running out. Yah's doing it again.
Yeah.
Because we're keeping the law the best we can.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Oh, all right. Let's move on to page 136.
Okay.
I didn't know you could do this with the PDFs.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
You
want to read the highlight for us, Elder? Anyone ever seen the churches, and they had the letters IHS.
Yeah.
Yes.
Y'all ever seen that?
Yeah.
Crushed, yeah.
What did they say that was for, Elder?
The monogram. I don't remember, but I've seen it.
IHS.
You ever seen it? You
seen it? I've seen it, but I never.
Nobody. I don't know what it's
called. I never thought
like
about what it meant.
Like the H is big, and the I is kind of like.
And the S is small on the small back, side.
When the preachers had them robes on sometimes.
Yeah.
Let's read what that's about, family.
There are letters on the wafer, that's where it was at, on communion wafer.
Yeah.
That's where it was at.
I know, me and my wife went to both, we didn't know each other, I would have scooped her up early, but we was at a Baptist church, and we had communion wafers.
You know, you know where else it is? In the crucifix.
Ooh.
In the middle of it.
Let's read what that IHS really is, family.
There are letters on the wafer that are worth reading. These letters are IHS. What mean these mystical letters? To a Christian, these are letters represented as signifying Iesus Hominem, Salvator, Jesus the Savior of men. But let a Roman worshiper of Isis, for in the age of the emperors, there were innumerable worshipers of Isis in Rome, cast his eyes upon them, and how will he read them? He will read them, of course, according to his own well-known system of idolatry, Isis, Horus, Seb, that is, the mother, the child, and the father of the gods. In other words, the Egyptian trinity.
What did that man in that book say? Jesus was a form of? Jesus was a form of Isis.
Isis, yeah.
Now we see Rona to Isis from the Egyptians. That's syncretism, syncretism. That's that Constantine. I'm taking everything. I'm taking a little bit of this. I'm taking a little bit of that.
Yeah.
That has nothing to do with our king. Mm-hmm. But again, and I got one resource says the Presbyterians and the Catholic popes, most of them was illiterate.
Yeah.
They're doing like people are doing today, getting sermons off the internet. Gina said, Gina found that internet. I said, yeah, man, you can download sermons. So all they was doing, some brothers doing the same thing now. Listen to a YouTube video, taking notes, and going regurgitating it. You ain't vetted it. You don't know it for yourself. So most of the preachers of the Roman diocese or whatever were ignorant anyway. Then you got our Israelites. We were whipped to set this mess. There was one resource says, by the time the Hebrews found out what they were really involved in, it was too late. They had sold their children, so I'd have sold my child.
Mm. Mercy.
Man.
The last part, and this is good. Before I say this, I gotta say something. Because we were talking one time, and I was like, this is why the origin of things matter. Mm. Cats be playing that, we can flip it, and, we can create the meaning of what it is. It's like, no. You know what I mean? Like, kind of like with the N-word. You know, we done made it to, to where it's acceptable. Yeah,
it's cool.
Yeah.
Is it not? I mean, if we're going back to the origin, it's not.
Nigger is the original is. Like nigger is the original is.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I try not to use the N-word no more, but yeah, the original is.
Yeah.
But well, our people didn't, when we flipped it, what his point is, when we flipped it, we didn't know that. Me and you got the information now. But when we started flipping it, like Richard Pryor, and Richard Pryor says, y'all see Richard Pryor's story?
Nah, I didn't see it.
Richard Pryor says when he went to Africa and seeing all the beautiful people, he's like, that's when he vowed not to use the N-word no more. But it's only recently we know nigger comes from negus, and it's a positive thing. So when we started using nigger, none of us really had knowledge that it really was a like part of our culture. We didn't have no, like right now, we say, if I call you a niger, I'm literally not assaulting you. We're black, we're dark people. Mm-hmm. But when we started flipping it in the hood or whatever, the art rap, or they didn't know they was, they doing what you saying, trying to turn, we don't change the meaning.
Well, and better yet, the word church, I'll use that one, that's more common. So, my old pastor, when we talked about this, he's like, and when people say not a Christian, well, I was like, you can't demonize a word, this, that, and the third. Again, his point was just like, it can take on a different meaning. You can change the meaning of a thing. But you only hold to that because that means something to you. Right. If it's something else, you're like, no, you can't change that. You know what I'm saying? If that makes sense.
We got to get all our definitions from the Most High.
Yeah.
Like this thing with Lord. I'm mature now, but when I first got to understand that Lord means Baal, I hated to hear Lord. Like when people pray Lord God, it's like, ugh. But now I understand they don't know. But Lord goes back to Baal in Phoenician. It's like the sisters calling each other bees. That blew my mind.
Bees?
Y'all used to smack fire out of people, and now y'all calling each other
bees.
Wait, let's move on.
All right.
Moving on. next. Okay. Y'all good. They like sponges.
Yeah. The initials IHS to pay the semblance of a tribute to Christianity, while paganism in reality has all the substance of the homage bestowed upon it. So that's what I'm saying. Yeah, y'all saying that, they'll let you get away with it. But those know, they know this is what it really means.
The sport you're saying, Elder, I'm a writer, so I'm going to bring the front street.
Yeah.
It's like me and you making a cologne called feces.
Yeah.
You ain't got that new feces? I thought it smelled good.
Yeah.
Like, nah, where I'm from, that stinks.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what they're doing. That's what elders saying they're doing.
Look like the cologne Musk.
Yeah. Musk.
Who wanna smell like Musk? You see, that's what elders say. Like they're trying to flip, and you gotta get to the source of it. You have to get, like people will ask us now that we're awakened. Well, what's wrong with doing Christmas? It's just
I was about to say exactly with Christmas.
Take it away,
they don't care about the origins of it. They're like, well, I'm not worshiping such and such and such. This is the birth of Jesus. And, you know, I don't care about the other stuff. This is what I'm doing. You can't sanctify it. You can't make it clean. If it's a pig, it's a pig. If you put lipstick on it, give it a bath, even spray perfume on it, it still grunts. It's a pig.
Okay, look up Isaiah 5 and 20 for me. Isaiah 5 and 20, back up what sister just said.
And to your point, love, like with that definition, if one of them Romans could be resurrected now, and you came telling them who Christmas was, they go, oh, that's...
They're
not
trying to
party. Yeah, we're partying.
And he's gonna start getting naked.
We're gonna have sex.
And so, like, what? What do you think? What I told my brother one time, I says, what if you had a box of prophylactics in your glove compartment and your wife found them? Yo, baby, they're just flotation devices. Sister, y'all laughing. So I can't, these. I know what to use for, but I don't use them like that.
Yeah.
What sister, what Hebrew sister in her right mind, like, okay, fool, you smart.
Yeah.
My husband's so smart. He's saving money because if he go buy the real tool, man, please. That's what they're doing with Christmas.
Yeah.
Yes.
We're not worshiping the tree. We're not worshiping the gifts.
Yeah.
You got it out.
Isaiah what?
Isaiah 5 and 20. I'm going from memory, so. I'm going from memory. And we can go to the last page 163, 161 and 163 for this two Babylons and wrap this one up.
Okay. Yeah, that one was
important. Isaiah, I think it's Isaiah 5 and 20. This is the support what Sister Nicola just saying when they come to us about their Christmas. And what's wrong with Valentine's? We should. I want my wife to know I love her. Well, according to the Torah, we should be letting her know every day. Like,
exactly.
I ain't got to adopt no pagan customs. Yeah. Isaiah 5 and 20.
Woe unto them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness. That you bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter.
So if we were one of those sword swinging groups, that would be swing. You can't call something evil good.
Yeah.
Like any Run DMC fans, I know y'all mean.
Not bad, meaning bad, but bad meaning good.
That's what not bad meaning bad, but bad meaning good. Yeah. You can't do that in the Torah.
Yeah.
If you serve the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, you can't say Christmas is holy now. You can't say, yeah, I know about Valentine's Day, but we ain't doing, I'm just buying my boo some gifts. If the Yah didn't ordain it, if one of the Levites didn't ordain it, we can't deal with it. Thank you, Markel, for that. Two Babylons, page 161.
That which is now called the Christian cross was originally no Christian emblem at all, but was the mystic town of the Chaldeans and Egyptians. The true original form of the letter T, the initial of the name of Tammuz, which in Hebrew, radically the same as ancient Chaldee, was found on coins.
We open up with Ezekiel chapter 8. Do you see this? And we didn't read the part about the women weeping for Tammuz. So that emblem that Constantine swore he's seen in the sky, that wasn't a cross. First of all, what no Israelite want to see no cross? You put my king on that thing. Why do I want that on my around my neck? But that emblem was a tall for Tammuz. So anywhere you slice that Cairo, it has nothing to do with us. Now, I'm going to show you the image before we wrap to show you how that whole image is blending like three or four different paganisms. So let's leave that for the sake of time. Let's wrap this up and bring this home. With that, you see the worship of Augustine right there, Elder? This is about to blow y'all. Y'all stay with me this whole thing. Now you about to just, whoo, this is about to blow your top off.
The worship of Augustine?
The worship of Augustine.
Oh, here?
Mm-hmm. The PDF. I found this, and I swear, I told y'all last week, I hate to say the spirit and all that crap, but it's like the most hobby, like, these links popping up. I'm like, let me check that out. I like, whoa, this right here, the worship of Augustine.
Does it start with as the father of the gods?
No, it's a different PDF.
Oh,
okay. Right there. So scroll so they can see the title page, Elder. This is the worship of August. This is the worship of Augustus Caesar. What did that man say at the Council of Nicaea? They were having, they narrowed the gods down to who? Caesar or Caesar, Mithra.
Zeus, and Horus, I think.
This is an ancient document that was written or published in the 1900s, and it proves they were worshiping Caesar or Caesar. They were worshiping him. So, real quick, because I know the family, I'm hungry. Let's go to page 14. Page 14. We're going to run down this and we're going to wrap this up. Jesus Christo is not the Messiah of Israel. He is not the son of the only begotten, the Most High. Jesus or Esus Christo is pagan sun worship, borrowed from Babylon.
Natural page 14.
I think you're right.
With the appearance of the original, of the Oriental Messiah.
You there?
Oh, okay.
This day is. I can't remember where it starts at.
Yeah.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Got you. Yeah, I'm about to get stronger glasses after a while. This is the worship of Augustus Caesar or Augustus Caesar, published in the 1900s. Hang in there for 5 more minutes, y'all. We almost done. This verifies that Rome originally had 10 months, and once they got involved with the Hebrews, they went up to 12 months. This document got so much history in it.
Does it start with right there? However, it was well observed.
I think it's right below that one. Okay. Might be, oh, there we go. Oh, Oriental dates.
You want to start here?
Give it here.
Or go back up.
Give it here.
The parents of the Oriental Messiah. On this page, we can start right here. The reincarnation. You see that reincarnation?
Reincarnation.
Come here, man.
Right there
in that paragraph, that last paragraph.
Oh, yeah. I see it.
Elder, read that paragraph, and please take note of the dates, y'all. Take note of the dates.
The reincarnation of Ayus Krishna, or Salavahana, occurred according to the Indian chronology in B.C. 736.
B.C. 736. This is way before Messiah. And you already see the name Hesus Krishna. Hesus Krishna. Keep reading, Elder, to this, Chaldeans.
To this, the Chaldeans added backward 12 years, making it B.C. 748, and called it the era Nebo Nazaru. To this again, the Romans of the Commonwealth added backward 66 years, making it B.C. 814.
One date just got changed into three different dates by three different nations. You see why they say 2019, we're supposed to be out of here, and we didn't go nowhere?
Yeah.
Because we don't even know what year. Roman them to play with a year so. Elder, read that again. Listen to what these people did.
To this again, the Romans and the Commonwealth added backward 66 years, making it B.C. 814, and called it the era of Quirinus or Romulus. Thus, 78 years were added backward to the area of the incarnation.
We don't know what year it is. These people just I'm just going to add years. So we don't know if it's 2019. It's not 2019. And I don't know if I can trust that research they went. It's like 5,000 something. They got this formula they came up with to calculate the years. I can't trust that. Point being, they're playing with the years. And the takeaway is, Hesus Krishna was already in 736 BC. Our ancestors was already around the world, so they knew our records. So everyone had their version of a Messiah. But the Messiah that Rome put up is not for us at all. Let's get the page 33.
In this same book?
Yeah, same book. We're gonna finish up with here. I think we showed concretely that Jesus Cristo is not the Messiah. This Jesus Cristo, aka Jesus Christ, is not the Messiah. He's a product of Babylonian sun worship. This Jesus character has been around forever, and he's nowhere related to Israel. You see Bel Jesus?
Yeah, Bel.
You know that Bel is related to Babylon. So Bel Jesus, he's the sun god of Babylon. Everything is related to Babylon, and our people just didn't take the time to do the research, just, you know, going to church shouting. It's not making sense. Hit the next one, Elder. Let's just run out Jesus.
Okay. Ice, Brahma changed to Ice Krishna. Page 33, that one.
Just keep hitting next. Let's just highlight the order. There it is. The Brahmical errors, the 11th avatar, B.C. 590 to 388, Gebel Asus Jesus. George cycles 470 B.C. Jesus. This Jesus character has nothing to do with our Messiah. Elder, can you scroll up once? You see those different years up there? Brahmical errors, 10th avatar, Ace Krishna. 1156 BC. This character has nothing to do with us. He's not the son of the Most High. He's not the only begotten. This Jesus Krishna, Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ, is all a form of Babylonian sun worship.